So, are there any questions? Any questions regarding box functions, hat functions, what we have done so far? No? Okay, that's fine. So, what we have done so far in the last class is we have defined hat functions. We have defined hat functions. And the hat function was defined as follows. The hat function centered about the point I, right. So there is some interval AB. We have created n plus 1 points which results in n intervals. The hat function centered about the point I. For now, for just for the sake of this discussion, we will assume that all the intervals are equal in size. But you see the way I have defined the hat function, they need not be of equal intervals, okay. So the points involved are xi, xi plus 1 and xi minus 1. So the hat function that is centered about xi takes the value 1 at xi and drops in a linear fashion to 0 at xi minus 1 and xi plus 1. And from there over the rest of the interval, in our problem, it is 0. So the support of the function, that is the support of the hat function, spans two intervals as opposed to the box function which was over only one interval, fine. So the ni's are not quite orthogonal to each other. So if you take ni dot nj, ni and we take the dot product with nj, they are not quite orthogonal to each other. So what does this turn out to be? What is ni dot nj? Well, if ni and nj were two functions, I and j are two functions that have absolutely no overlap, then we know what the answer is. So they have absolutely no overlap, right. So if this is nj, then ni dot nj is 0. On the other hand, if they do have an overlap, the overlap can come in different forms. One is that the overlap can be over the interval xi minus 1 xi. It could be over the interval xi xi plus 1, or it could be over the whole xi minus 1 to xi plus 1, okay. So we have three cases. So what are, what do they work out to? What is ni minus 1 dotted with ni, right? Ni minus 1 dotted with ni is a hat function that is centered at I minus 1. Is centered at I minus 1 and is 0 everywhere. See, the overlap clearly is over the interval xi minus 1 xi, okay. So this in fact turns out to be the integral xi minus 1 to xi xi minus 1 to xi. Ahead, obviously, right? Alpha y x times 1 minus alpha y. Alpha of that I or I minus 1? I call that I or I minus 1 dx. Where alpha of I as a function of x is x minus xi minus 1 divided by xi minus xi minus 1. I have a feeling I defined it as alpha I minus 1 yesterday, but it does not matter. I have a feeling I may have defined this as alpha I minus 1, it does not matter. What does this integral turn out to be? Xi minus 1 divided by 6. You can check this out. You can check that out. Okay. Now, what about the other possibility, which is Ni dot Ni, that is I equals j, right? This was j is I minus 1, this is j equals I. This gives me the integral Xi minus 1 to Xi plus 1 Ni squared dx. Okay. And what will this turn out to be? You have to split this into two. This is just integration, so I am going to leave you to do it. Xi Ni squared dx plus Xi to Xi plus 1 Ni squared dx. Each one of them is basically, each of these elements here is basically linear. Linear square gives me a quadratic, integrated gives me a cubic, right? There are two of them. So this in fact turns out to, you can check this out, 2/3 Xi, 2/3 Xi plus 1 minus Xi, and we are assuming equal intervals. You have to be a little more careful here because these intervals may not be the same. That is, Xi plus 1 minus Xi is the same as Xi minus 1 is like some h. Okay, since I have introduced the idea of an h here, this is like h by 6 and this is like 2h by 3. Fine, okay. And what's the other one? The other one is going to be the same now. Ni plus 1 dotted with Ni is going to be basically h by 6. So Ni dot Nj otherwise, so if for all other j, for all other j meaning j not equal to, for all other j, j not equal to I minus 1, I plus 1 for all other j. What do we have? Ni, Nj, Ni or Ni, Nj equals 0. Okay. Not quite orthogonal. Not quite orthogonal. So it is not as good as the box functions, right. So we have an overlap. We have an overlap that consists of 3 of these functions. So we will have to worry about that. Every time we take a dot product or something of that sort, we will have to worry about that. But what did we get in exchange for that? What we got in exchange for that is that we can represent on any given interval, we can represent a linear function. So if you take I minus 1, I plus 1 using the hat function, of course using one hat function, if you have only one hat function, you can only change that one value, right. Using one hat function you can only change one value, but the minute you introduce another hat function you can actually represent a linear interpolant between the two. Is that fine? So what we have got, what we have is that we have an overlap of the hat functions and therefore we do not have pure orthogonality, but we have locality. We have locality in the sense that if I were to change this one value, all it would do is influence the function in these two intervals. It is not one interval like in the box function, but it is only two intervals. It is not as though over the whole interval, if I have a polynomial and I change the value, then the function changes on the whole interval. Okay, on the whole length of our problem domain, whereas here we have broken it up into sub intervals, right, and in the length I minus we can restrict any change that I make here, we can restrict it to those two intervals. Is that fine? Okay. So we don't quite have orthogonality, but we have some element of orthogonality between the various functions. Okay, right? So both in the case of the box functions and in the case of hat functions, I am not going to bother to make these orthonormal. Okay, I am not going to try to make them normal, which means I am not going to try to make their magnitude 1. And in the case of the box function also, I did not bother to make the magnitude 1. I did not bother to make the magnitude 1. Why would I do that? What do I gain from it? Why would I do that? Look at this function or look at this function. Why would I do that? Why would I leave the value to which the function grows, the hat function grows, why would I leave it at 1? Clearly ni, which is the magnitude, is 2/3, right, 2/3 h. So instead of going up to 1, if I go up to square root of 3/2 h, then the magnitude ni dot ni would be 1. Why don't I bother to do it? So constructing, finding the coefficients will be easier. That's the key. Finding the coefficients will be easier. I'll tell you what I mean by that. So let me leave that because I'll need that a little later. I'll tell you what I mean by this. So if we were to say that f of x, I'm going to represent as summation over I. I'm not going to look at the right upper limit and lower limit. We look at that. That's why that figure is left there. Ai ni. And since I've already introduced the idea that h is like xi plus 1 minus xi for any I, right? So I've changed it from h equals to h is like. Okay, because we know that there need not be actually equal intervals. So I'll introduce this notation. I may not consistently follow this notation, but this is just so that you're aware of the notation. Okay, where it is clear, I'll drop the h. But very often, to distinguish between the function that we want to represent and its representation, to distinguish between them, we stick an h on top. Right? I may use different f's, but we stick an h on top. Right? To distinguish between a representation that is on some grid, right? I'm using this word grid for the first time. Some grid, which is typically of size h. I'll call it f of h, and f is the original function that we are trying to represent. I do this because we are aware now that these two need not be the same; that there is an error in representation. So to distinguish between the two, I give it a notation that's like this. So f of h is ai in I. If we followed the usual process, what we would have to do is we would have to take dot products to find the coefficient. But if I let ni go only up to 1, then I have the advantage that if the function value at the ith grid point is say 0.5 and ni itself takes a magnitude only 1, then ai turns out to be 0.5. That's the idea. Okay, so finding the coefficients is easy. If you have tabulated data, you perform an experiment, you have tabulated data, you want to find the hat function representation to it, you have the coefficients in the tabulated data, you already have it. That's the idea, right? That's the advantage. That's why I don't make it normal. I don't make it a unit vector. If I make it a unit vector, then I lose that. I'll have to go through and process the data more. So it helps me in a situation here, it helps me not to have to process that data, right? So the AIs become automatically the values, the function values at those nodal points. Is that clear? Fine, everyone? Okay. So AI is the function value or the value of the function f of xi. So this in fact becomes f of h x is summation over I f of xi, which I'll very often just call I fi ni. And this should be from, this should really be, the summation should really go from 1 through n, but we have to say something about what happens at the endpoints. Okay. So let's go back here and see what happens at the endpoints. So what do I have here? So apparently I have one interval here. So I have that. And finally, there's nothing on the left hand side. My problem starts here. So I only get half a hat function. So my very first function, if I were to draw it separately, my very first function would be this. N1 or N0, depending on, I do have to be a bit careful with my, because I have, the count starts from 0. So I have, that is 0. That's 1, and it goes on, that's I plus 1. Then we go to the other extreme. Let's go to the other extreme. What do we have at the other extreme? We have one more hat function here. One more hat function here. And finally I have one last hat function here. And that will turn out to be the last hat function. Will turn out to be this function. There are n intervals, and this is going to be, the count starts at 0. The count starts at 0, that's going to be n. So the upper limit is going to be n. Is that fine? Okay. Are there any questions? Using these functions, it's actually possible now that we can represent any function that we want as a piecewise linear straight line, polyline. So if you had some functional variation, you have the function values, the f's at xi, it's actually possible for you, right, to represent it as a polyline, right, piecewise straight lines, and it's continuous. Are there any questions? Yeah.
Unlike the box functions here, we don't have the property that the integral is under.
Unlike the box function.
The box function, we saw that the integral is under, integral f of x and integral f of x.
Integral f of x and integral f h of x is the same. Well, we'd actually have to find out, is it not conserved? We need to do a little analysis as to what we have right now. Okay. So one of the things that we have to do is, maybe some things I will do, some things I will leave for you to try it out. So first question that you have is, what is f of x minus f h of x, the norm of this? Okay. So this is one question. What is the norm of this? Am I making sense? So in a sense, that's connected to what you're saying right now. So what is this norm? What does this turn out to be? Why did it work there? What is the, in the case of the box function, right here it's very clear. Here I said I left it as 1 so that the function value comes out immediately. In the case of the box function, what did we get in exchange? So in the case of the box function, do you understand the question? I said that I have a box function, and I said that I left this at 1. Right, I left this magnitude, the magnitude of the box function, I left it at 1. I could have made it a unit vector by making its magnitude square root of n. I could have made the magnitude square root of n, and it would have been a unit vector. The dot product with itself would have been 1, whereas I didn't do it. So I left it at 1. There must be some advantage that I got because of that. Okay, so this will turn out that this is basically the average value. The area under this is what is the value here will be the average value of the function over this interval. You can just check and see whether that has a consequence with, right? Okay, so on the other hand, here we need to know what this is. Just like we did for the box function, you need to try this out and make sure that, right, you get an expression for this. Just try it out. I would suggest that you try functions of various kinds. Let's look at, I'll just name a few and we'll see what happens. So if I have a constant function, hat functions, I can represent it exactly, right? This norm is 0, meaning I can represent it exactly. If I have a linear, again 0, so the representation is definitely of order 1. If it's quadratic, then I'm going to have a problem, right? So you can use a quadratic, try to represent a quadratic and see from there what is this error. See if you can get an expression for the error, okay. See if you can get an expression for the error. So that will tell you something about the nature of the error, the error term. Please do this. The error term will tell you the nature of the error, and it will also tell you what happens as we shrink, as we allow h to go to 0, what is the rate at which that error goes to 0. So it is important that you derive that expression, fine. The other thing that we want is, I want to make sure that we get this, that hat functions provide a first order representation. Right, the box function was a 0th order representation, that means a polynomial, a constant, was represented exactly. In the case of the hat function, it provides a first order representation. We can up to a linear can be represented exactly. Is that fine? Okay. Okay. Let's see what else we can now do. Is it possible for us to go for higher order representations? Is there a way that we can get higher order representations? Okay. So we would obviously want to use polynomials of higher order. We want polynomials of higher order, okay. We want polynomials of higher order. But I suspect, just like going from a constant to a linear, when we went from constant to linear, we went from one interval to two intervals. I suspect if we go from linear to a quadratic, that possibly we will have to go to three intervals, okay. So what is the nature of those functions that we can use? So we saw that alpha of x was like x minus alpha I of x, xi by xi plus 1 minus xi was something that we could start off with a linear. It turns out we can actually use these to construct polynomials of higher order, okay. So if I define three functions now on a given interval, ni 0 is alpha I of x squared, it is clearly a quadratic. Ni of 1 is alpha I into 1 minus alpha I, also clearly a quadratic. Ni 2, I have three such functions, will be 1 minus alpha I squared. There will be a 2 there, and ask the question, how do you know there is a 2 there? How do I know there is a 2 there? All of these, ni 0 plus ni 1 plus ni 2, ni 2 add to 1. Does that work? Why should they add to 1? No, no, but why, see, this is over the same interval. Please remember, this is over the same interval. This is over the interval xi, xi plus 1. This is over the interval xi, xi plus 1. What do these functions look like? One is going to be a quadratic that is like this. One is going to be a quadratic, the slope is not 0 here, that is like this. And the third is going to be a quadratic that is like this. Okay, this would in fact be this one. Okay, so question that we have is why should these add up to 1? In fact, if you look at the hat functions, you will see that they are all there too. Even there they add up to 1. Why do they add up to 1? If you look at the hat functions here, ni 0 plus ni 1, ni 0, my notation has changed a little, ni, I called it ni plus 1, 0 and ni 1, add up to 1. Why do they add up to 1? If they did not add up to 1, what is the big deal? You cannot represent a constant. You won't be able to represent a constant, right? And there will be some sort of funny interpolation going on now over and above, right? If this did not add up to 1, that means that it would be, it is varying in some fashion. If it did not add up to 1, it is varying in some fashion. If it did not add up to a constant, if it did not, 1 is convenient. If it did not add up to a constant, that means it is varying in some fashion. Am I making sense? Right? Okay. And at any given point in the interval, at any given point in the interval, we want the function value to be there to be, it is a linear combination of these three. It is a convex combination of these three. Is that fine? Okay. So we do not want any other variation. We want the variation that we have picked here and that should be picked up by these three functions, and therefore they have to add up to a constant, and 1 is a very convenient constant to pick. Okay. So in this case, just like we did ai bi there, we could actually say ai ni 0 plus bi ni 1 plus ci ni. You would have the sum of these three quantities. Is that okay? As we go along, you will see that I leave more and more of the details of working things out to you. Is that fine? This is quadratic. So what it allows me to do again is, I have a function that is 0 at this end, 1 at that end, right, starts at 0 at this end, goes to 1 at that end, okay, fine. So it is possible for me to independently vary what happens to the function on either sides of the interval, right. And also there seems to be, this seems symmetric about this, this figure does not, but it should be symmetric about that, right, and there is a slope that is fixed at both sides. I do not have that much of a great preference for quadratics, I just do it for completion, so to speak. I will go on to something that is more important, which is cubics. So in the case of cubics, we would define how many? 4 functions. We will define 4 functions, which are ni 0, ni 1, ni 2, ni 3, and these should be relatively easy for you to figure out now. So ni 0 would be alpha I cube, it is a function of x, I am not going to keep writing that. Ni 1 would be alpha I squared, 3 of them into 1 minus alpha I, right. So in your mind you should be thinking a plus b whole cubed. Ni 2 would be 3 of 3 times alpha I, 1 minus alpha I square, and ni, the last one would be 1 minus alpha I cubed. Is that fine? So this is a, this is just a simple algebraic process that I am going through, and clearly the sum of these, sum over j of ni j's is again 1, because the sum of the 4 of these will give me alpha I plus 1 minus alpha I whole cubed, right, which is 1, which is where these constants came from. And now it is actually possible for you yourself to construct, right, any order that you want. Now that you have seen this process, it should be obvious that you can construct any order that you want. Is that fine? So why did I skip quickly over the cube, quadratic, and go to the cubic? Well, the cubic is an interesting function. The cubic is an interesting function. Because it gives me control over the function values at the endpoints, and so this is well, I just call it y right now, xi plus 1. The cubic allows me to do this. The cubic, the slope here is 0, the slope there is 0, right. So it is going to go the 0 slope to 1 there, right. The other function, 1 minus alpha I cubed, is going to start at the 0 slope and 0 value here, that is important, 0 slope and 0 value, and goes up to 1 there. Is that fine? Okay. The next two functions do something that is interesting. Let me choose the next two functions do something interesting. So they start with a non-zero slope on the one side and have a zero slope on the other side. Okay. They start with a non-zero slope on one side and have a zero slope on the other side. Okay. So by, on this interval, by using these four functions and using AI, let me, okay, AI NI 0 plus BI NI 1 plus CI NI 2 plus DI NI 3. By using these four functions and these four coefficients, it is possible for me using the first one AI to move this value up and down. You understand what I am saying? Just to change a single value alone. It is possible for me to use DI and to change, move this value up and down independent of the others. It is possible for me to use BI and CI to actually manipulate the slope. Do you understand what I am saying? So in a sense, in representing the function value, I have now got what I would call as the ultimate in locality. I managed now, right, it is not quite the ultimate, obviously you can go to higher order, but we like the direction in which we are going, that we are able to manipulate the function value and you are able to simultaneously manipulate the slopes at these points. Okay, and what is the cost that we paid, what is the price that we paid in exchange for this? We have more, we have a higher order polynomial, of course, we have more coefficients to handle, we have more intervals involved, right, there will be more intervals involved, more intervals involved. So we will end up having overlap over multiple intervals. So what I want you to do is, I want you to try the following for both quadratic and cubic representations. Right. So right, I basically say quadratic and cubic representations. You know that the quadratic will represent anything up to a second degree polynomial, right? And the cubic is going to represent any polynomial accurately up to a third degree polynomial, right? And beyond that, of course, then you're going to have errors. So for both of these, you need to find, please make sure that you're able to find f minus f of x minus fh of x, the norm. What else do we want? Which means that for a quadratic, obviously it will represent a quadratic properly, it is likely that a cubic won't work. Try a cubic, try a quartic, even with a quadratic, try higher order polynomials to see what is it that you get. And for cubics it is the same thing, right, up to a cubic it works. If you have a doubt, try it out. And try a quartic, try a quintic to see whether, what does the error term turn out to be, how does the error term work out, okay. How does it work out? One, what is the error term and how does it converge? So one is find this and look at it to see as h goes to 0, how does it converge? What is the order? What is the rate at which it goes to 0? Is it like h? Is it like h squared? Is it like h cubed? Right? What is the rate at which it goes to 0? Is that fine? Okay. Right. So what we have now is a way by which we are able to represent functions of various orders on any interval. We have a mechanism by which we are able to find the, what should I say, the error in our representation. We are, hopefully once you have done the assignment, you will see that for all of them, you are in a way, you have a mechanism by which you are able to find the rate at which you get convergence, okay. We will say a few words now about what I mean by that, the rate at which we get convergence, the magnitude of the error, and you have a mechanism by which you know what is the order of representation, right. The idea of what is the order of representation is something that is clear, okay. So what do I mean by convergence? In this context, what do I mean by convergence? You take some of these terms that we have used. What do I mean by convergence? So as h goes to 0, h which is like xi plus 1 minus xi for all i's, so they are all of the same order of magnitude. As this goes to 0, which means that n goes to infinity, the intervals get smaller and smaller and the number of intervals becomes larger and larger. We are asking the question, does f of h go to f? First question, does f of h go to f, right, which means that it converges. And the second question is, at what rate? Do you have convergence and at what rate? Okay. Right, so this is the first definition that you are seeing of convergence. We will see different types of convergence. I want to make sure you have to be, it depends on the context. I want you to keep this in mind. So this is, as h goes to 0, we have a representation. The question that we have is, what is the rate at which the representation that we have goes to the actual function? What is the rate at which the representation error goes to 0? Okay. So, and as I said, there is always this question, does it indeed go to 0? And if it goes to 0, what is the rate at which it goes to 0? Is that okay? Fine. So what we will do is maybe we will consider now how useful this is in what we have set out to do, which is solve differential equations. We have figured out a way to find out what is the order, that is if you give me the data. So that is the reason why the example that I gave you earlier was, if you perform an experiment, you have tabulated data. From that tabulated data, it is very easy for you to fit. You understand? Especially for hat functions, it is very straightforward for you to just extract the data and use it, right? Directly plot. All you are doing is linear interpolation, if you think about it. The only thing that I am telling you now is, every time you use linear interpolation earlier, you are actually using hat functions. It is that awareness that I want. Every time in an experiment or in any work that you have done earlier, every time you had data and you connected it by straight lines, you are actually using hat functions. That is what you have to be aware of. you understand what I am saying? Every time you connected it by piecewise straight lines, you are actually using hat functions. Okay, that's the key. So this is a situation where you have the data points ahead of time. This is a situation where you have the data. What happens if you don't have the data points ahead of time? This is what we encounter typically when we are trying to solve differential equations. So if I had a dynamical equation, a dynamical system, a system that's varying in time, I want to predict its behavior in the future. So I could in essence have some dx dt which is f of x comma t, and this is something that is varying in time, and I don't have x. This could be a particle that is traveling, for instance, right, propagation of a particle. X could be its position. So I have dx dt related in this fashion. I may not have a priori before I start. I may not have the data points in hand for me to fit a function. Okay, so I can decide that I am going to use linear interpolants of some kind. I can make that decision, but is it possible for me to say beforehand, get an estimate as to what is the error that I am likely to make, or are they related, is it the same? Does this question make sense? See, in the one case it should be clear to you that if I give you the data, that you are able to use the data and interpolate. It is all a matter of representing the function. But we saw the motivation that we used for why we are setting out to represent functions on the computer is that we don't know what the function is, and we want to come up with an algorithm to hunt for the function. There are different ways by which this can happen. In fact, it is possible to use those. We will see how to use those functions later on. But right now, as it stands, right, the problem that I posed to you is, if I had a differential equation which I am integrating out in time, I deliberately choose time because that's in the future, and I'm saying you don't know what the value is, right? So if I deliberately integrating out in time, is there a way for me, before I start the integration, to say this is the nature of the function, this is the representation that I'm going to use, this is how it's going to, this is the error that I'm going to make in my representation. Fine. So there is a different kind. I want to march off. I want to step off, given that I have some initial condition x0, I would like to find x1 somehow, which is very different from a situation that we had there, which was basically given data representing the data. Okay, right. So what we are going to do is, we are going to take a different, slightly different tack. We are going to see, here we have already seen, especially for the box function, we have already seen that the error was of the order of 1 over n, which basically means that the error was of the order of h. And you will see when you do this, you will find out errors, again errors in terms of h. Okay, so this may not be an obvious trigger for you, but what I would say is, we will see whether we can approximate functions, we can approximate a function. At time t plus delta t, given the value at t. Fine. Okay. So I'll use an example that may make you uncomfortable, but what the heck. So you've all been taking quizzes, exams, and all of that kinds of stuff so far, right? So 6 semesters are done. Next semester you go for interviews. People look at your grades. They say, at this point in time, after 6 semester, this is your cumulative grade point average. This is your grade. What is your grade likely to be at the end of 8 semesters? That's a question that we are asking. Given at time t, that I have a function value, your grade point average at a given time, what is your grade point average likely to be at t plus 2 semesters? Someone interviewing you, giving you, sitting across the table and asking you questions, they look at your score sheet and they want to make an estimate. Fine. So give me a good estimate. What would, so you, if you say have a grade point average which is 8.5, what would you tell them? What would I do if I were interviewing you? What would you do if you were interviewing me? What's a good estimate? It's likely that it's the same, right? One good estimate is it's likely that it's the same. Okay, you made this. This is a cumulative grade point average over the last 6 semesters. It's likely that after at the end of 8 semesters, this is going to be your CGPA. Am I making sense? So it's likely. So one thing, one way by which we could do it is, so if you give me x of t, it's likely that x of t plus delta t is like approximately x of t. That's an approximation, right? And I've changed the language that I'm using now. So far I've been talking about representations on the computer, but our experience so far, I'm now admitting it's an approximation. It doesn't look like we're going to be able to represent functions exactly on the computer, right? So it's going to be an approximation. So now I come, we have to live with this reality. I come now to the point where we say it is an approximation. It is an approximation. I want to now ask the question, what is the approximation? What is the value? And what is the error in that value? Okay. And I pose this question in this fashion because it immediately motivates. It immediately motivates. If you look at something like x plus t plus delta t, what do you want to do? Expand using Taylor series. Am I making sense? Anytime you look at something like x plus t plus delta t, you say, oh, why don't we just expand using Taylor series? Okay. So that's basically what we are going to do. Essentially, what we will do is we will now sort of reset, right? That was the notation we introduced so far, but we will go into standard notation. So if I have f of x given f of x, what is f of x plus delta x? I introduced the notion of t and time just to motivate the fact that you may not know the function ahead of time. That's the only reason why I use t. So the question is, given f of x, what is a good approximation for f of x plus delta x? Well, you can say f of x plus delta x, a good approximation is f of x, right? So if I am getting something today, if my salary is f of x today, a good approximation is f of x plus x plus delta x, right? That it's the same salary. So it's a reasonable approximation. It may or not all, it may not always be right, but it's a reasonable approximation. So what is the nature of the error? Use Taylor series. F of x plus delta x is f of x plus delta x times the derivative f prime x. So the prime indicates differentiation with respect to x. Delta x squared by 2 f double prime of x plus an infinite number of terms. And I am assuming that f of x plus delta x is f of x. And in making this assumption, I have thrown away all these terms in Taylor series. Okay. All of these terms, infinite number of terms, I have thrown them away. I have an infinite series which I have truncated. Right. The error that you create by taking an infinite series and truncating it is called a truncation error. Right? If you have an infinite series representation for say a function, the error that you make by throwing away a whole bunch of these terms is called a truncation error. And we will represent the order of the error by the leading term, which is delta x. So the error, truncation error here, is of order of delta x f prime of x. Is that fine? Right? So we tend to call this a first order error because the exponent over delta x is 1, right? Okay. So we will come back to this maybe on Monday. I will try to do a demo of some kind then. I would suggest that you try using hat functions and representing various and sundry functions, as many different types of functions as you can. Okay. And I will come back in the next class then. Maybe try to do a demo so that you can see there are some issues still with respect to representing functions. Fine, I'll see you in the next class.